Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick in the Philippines. Been revived by the Lord. Just got through praying. Been having these brownouts here, or what they call in the Philippines brownouts, what they call in the States a blackout. Rolling blackouts. Keeps increasing from 2 hours a day to 4 hours a day to 6 hours a day. Now they're saying 7.5 hours a day because of no rain in the area, an increase of electrical use. Anyway, brothers and sisters, by the grace of God, I ask you to pray for that. I know that the Lord gives us the power to overcome all things and to push through and do His will. And by the grace of God, brothers and sisters, I still have enough time to do the part of my ministry, which involves the internet. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I was just praying, and I've been kind of tired out, of course, as you can imagine, with all this, you know, because it's like 100 degrees here every day, okay? And it's a very loud, noisy country. Animals and people and yelling and carrying on. And when I got a little wall unit air conditioner, when that thing's out, you know, you can hear a whole lot more noise. So loud. Power outage through the night, daytime, anytime they can have it. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I was kind of feeling down about it all the things going on, trying to get ready to move to the States. And anyway, I began to pray. You know, that's the thing we got to do. We just got to push through, you know. And we start out in our flesh, you know, wait on the Lord to show up. And that's, you know, there's sometimes the Lord leads us to pray, and sometimes we just got to force ourselves. You know, you got to have the discipline to force yourself. You start out in the flesh, and then later on the Lord will begin to honor your persistence and pour out His Spirit on you. Brothers and sisters, and I know there's lots of people, the number one thing people ask me about, who are real Christians? It's about being baptized in the Holy Ghost. And I want to talk to you guys about that. But listen, that's the thing about it. When someone asks me a question, or I'll make a video and I'll put, you know, how to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit or something, even though I go into all the A, B, C, D about it, I'm talking, and people, you know, they don't have an ear to hear. They're in the flesh, so they're like, well, you know, what are you talking about? I don't know why the Lord did it. As if you guys heard me talking about it, I started three or four by my, you know, with other people helping me, four churches. I started other Filipino pastors, but I started, I guess, two or three completely, you know, just me and the Lord. And anyway, in those groups, they were brand new Christians, and the Lord had me talking all this way deep stuff. And it's like this, you know, give a man a fish, he'll eat for a day, teach him to fish, he'll fish for a lifetime. So in reference that to the Lord, instead of just telling people, because people always ask me something like, you know, Brother Patrick, you know, how do I get healed? Or Brother Patrick, how do I receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit? Or, you know, Brother Patrick, about this or that, or how can you hear from the Lord? Or, you know, I want to hear from the Lord. Or, you know, I want to hear a word of wisdom from the Lord and all that. Besides the fact that biblically speaking, God does speak to all of us. But as far as the gift of the word of wisdom, word of knowledge, God, the Lord, the Holy Spirit, divides the gifts among us severally as He wills. So not everyone has the gift of prophecy or that supernatural level of faith is one of the gifts. There's nine gifts there. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, they're lifted the gifts of healing. And not everyone has the gift of healing, even though God could use you in the gift of healing anytime. And that's a whole nother topic. I don't want to get off topic, but it's possible. You know, God could activate any of those gifts in any of us anytime, and then He could just use you one time to pray for somebody to be healed, and then never again. You know, it doesn't mean that, hey, you're going to be used always in the gift of healing, even though you may have the gift, but it's not always active. Anyway, that's a whole other topic. Let me stay on topic. Anyway, so listen to me. Those of you who want to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, those of you who want to hear from God, those of you who want to be used by God, you know, that's the whole thing. Brothers and sisters, I'm not talking about this is the ABC. That's in the flesh. I'm talking about, hey, you got to get a hold of those spiritual things. You know, if you know the God, if you knew, in other words, you got to know the Lord. It's not knowing about the Lord. It's just like I could sit here and read all the biographies and every book and everything's ever been written in the history of the world about President Obama or, you know, former President Bush or whomever. Okay, and then I can tell you, oh, you know, that President Bush is 6'1". You know, I don't think he jogs anymore. He used to jog 5 miles a day early in the morning, and he hurt his knee or something. Now he rides a bicycle or whatever. You're talking about former President W. Bush. I could go on and on. I could tell you all kinds of facts, whatever. I don't know that, you know what I'm saying. I could tell you that his favorite food is this, his favorite color is this, blah, blah, blah. Say, wow, you sure do know President Bush a lot. And then here comes, and let's just say that President Bush came here. Oh, President Bush is coming here. Former President Bush. He comes here to the Philippines, and then when he sees me, I'll be like, hey, what's up, W? And he's going to be like, who are you? I don't know you. See? So I would know about, I know about President Bush, which I haven't really done it, but I know about him because I've read all about him. Know every statistic there is to know, everything he ever said, watch every speech, read everything he ever wrote and said. I know about him, but I don't know him. And that's the problem with lots of people. They want to operate in the gift of healing. They want to, you know, operate in the gifts. They want to, you know, be called up to the third heaven. They want to experience this, experience that. But you got to know him. You got to know the Lord. So that's the difference. You can, and I can, I know it in my spirit, and lots of mature Christians I talk to, they do too. I can go at any church or any performance, anytime, almost 100% of the time, I can hear someone do a praise and worship song, and I know in the first 30 seconds whether this person is performing for man or performing for the Lord. If this person is anointed or not anointed, it doesn't matter what the title of the song is. People who will say, well, that song is anointed. God can quicken a song to you to hear and receive, to get a message out of. And the Lord does that to me on a regular basis. But as an example, I've told this many times. When I first started, I was assistant pastor in a Baptist church before I was filled with the Holy Spirit, before I even knew any of that stuff. I was unchurched, only as a kid going to vacation Bible school. I got saved or came back to the Lord, my calling to serve the Lord. Started out with the Baptist church that I got saved with. Went back there. The pastor knew me. He invited me to start teaching Sunday school. I didn't know anything. So there's a Southern Gospel group called the Martins. They came to sing at the largest Baptist church, second largest in North Carolina, there in Winston-Salem. I went to hear them sing. And I listened to the choir in that church. They had sang some in the beginning. And they tried to sing the same songs that I'd heard at a spirit-filled churches I went to. And they sang those Pentecostal songs, but it was just like listening to a two-dimensional version of a three-dimensional song. It was flat, dead, tone-deaf, it was anti-anointed. You could have got a bunch of worldly people, unsaved people together, and it would have been more anointed than that. Something about that. Tell you what, I would say this too. I prayed with thousands of people, brothers and sisters, thousands of people, laid hands on. As a matter of fact, this 1 3-day weekend of doing a medical mission and evangelism crusade in one town here, where we do the feedings at now, most of the feedings, not all, the majority of the feedings we do in this one place. In that same town, I went with a doctor. And we did a medical missions last evangelism crusade. And just that 3-day weekend, I prayed for 1,000 people. And I've done that I don't know how many times. So thousands of people, brothers and sisters. And out of that, there's been about 3 or 4 people who I prayed with. I'll say 4 people I prayed with who the Holy Spirit would not enter. 2 of them were atheist and 2 of them were Baptist. That's it. Every Catholic I've ever prayed for that said, yes, I can pray for them, the Holy Spirit entered them. No problem. No problem. They were not resistant. And I'm going to tell you what the secret is and the reason why. It's called blaspheme of the Holy Spirit. Exactly what it is. It's blaspheme of the Holy Spirit. You talk about people having idolatry, even though they claim Jesus and the gospel, and then they add, praying and asking Mama Mary to help them and all that stuff. Those are all forgivable things. Those are all things where forgive them. They know not what they do. People can be ignorant. But blaspheme of the Holy Spirit, as the Lord said, that is the unforgivable sin. And that is the sin that I've run into in that particular group that I just mentioned. But I want to tell you what the Lord was showing me. I'm trying to get to this. And I am talking about it. When I do my videos, sometimes people think I'm people that are, they're thinking in the natural way. I'm not saying anything about somebody that I'm smarter than anybody, but I'm speaking in a spiritual way. He who has an ear, let him hear. It's the same topic. It's not, the problem is people want to hear, you know, you want to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, do A, B, C, D. And that's truth to that. But you have to get to know the Lord, and then you don't need to, it's not a 12-step program, you know, like, you know, Stuart Smalley, you know, who's been to several 12-step programs, but a master of none or whatever it is, you know. You have to know the Lord. Now listen to me. This is what the Lord showed me. I was praying. I never even thought about this. I've read the text. You know, there's tons of things in the Bibles I never sat around and meditated on. What's the meaning of it? Or thought about it. But I saw the hand of the Lord, brothers and sisters, and he opened up his hand, and right in the middle of his hand where the wound, the nail print was a great big pearl. And then I immediately, before I could even say, what is this? I heard a voice say, pearl of great price. You know, and me, because I haven't thought about that text, I know because I'd been looking at some Mormonism stuff, not now, several. I studied Mormonism when I first went to Bible school and all that. I took a course on world religions, and I remember that Joseph Smith wrote a book called Pearl of Great Price. So I said, is the Lord talking to me about the Mormons? And the Lord is like, no, I'm the one that said it's a pearl of great price. I was like, yes, of course, the Lord is the one who said it. The Lord is the one who used that expression. And then inside that pearl, brothers and sisters, is the kingdom of God. Inside that pearl is the bride of Christ. It's inside the pearl in the Lord's hand. And let me read this text to you. Jesus is talking about the kingdom of heaven. This is what I'm trying to talk to you about. This is what I'm trying to get to. For he who has an ear, let him hear. Now let me say it plainly. Plainly. As Paul said, let me speak to you as cardinal. You know, I have to speak to you in an elementary level. Listen to what Jesus says. He's talking about the kingdom of heaven. He says, again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a treasure hid in a field, in which when a man hath found it, he hideth that treasure for the joy thereof, and goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a merchant seeking godly pearls, who when he has found one pearl of great price, went and sold all that he had and bought it. This is Matthew chapter 13. I started at verse 44. 45, 46, 47. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a net that is cast into the sea and gathered of everything. I don't want to get into that about separating the wheat from the tares. I just want to look at this section. This is what the Lord wants me to talk to you about. The pearl of great price. Let me read it again. 44, 45, and 46. Matthew 13. And again, the kingdom of heaven, this is the Lord Jesus Christ talking, is like unto a treasure hid in a field, in which a man hath found, he hideth that treasure, and for joy thereof goeth and sell all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a merchant man seeking goodly pearls, who when he hath found one pearl of great price, went and sold all that he has and bought it. Excuse me. So that is the message from the Lord. That's the message from the Lord. This is for the New Beginning Church. I mentioned the name of a church I helped start. I was the only white guy there, if you've been watching my videos. It was all black people and me. And then we started in it. The pastor, I was his assistant pastor, he started in a Hispanic neighborhood. How about that? I've mentioned that before. It's all black people. I was the only white person, and we started in a Hispanic neighborhood. How about that for a church? It was called New Beginning Church of the Glory. Anyway, that's why I mentioned that. Church of the Firstborn, the Church of the Firstborn that the Lord gave me to start online, reference to Hebrews chapter 12. It's talking about going in the rapture, going to be the bride and going up there to heaven. That's what it's about, preparing the people. And those who are going to be part of the bride, brothers and sisters, not just people would chat on Church of the Firstborn, but who the Lord would have me work with. And then all the other people that will be part of the body and bride of Christ. We have to become a people. We have to become a people who are not afraid to worship the Lord. Who are not afraid to give him all the glory. We're not afraid to sell everything we have and follow the Lord. Like I said, I haven't really ever gotten into my testimony. But it's a little bit here and there. And there's people that's done a whole lot more for the Lord than I have. A million times more for the Lord than I did. Like the Apostle Paul or whomever you could think of. They gave up everything for the Lord. But I believe the Lord would have me say, even though I haven't done nearly as much as lots of people that were fed to the lions and all that stuff. They're in Rome, and whatever's happened to people. Well, who knows, though? Who knows what the future holds, right? Only the Lord knows what tomorrow holds for any of us. But I got the call from the Lord, and I saw that the Lord was good. The Bible says, taste and see that the Lord is good. I saw that the Lord had for me, and that the Lord is a pearl of great price. And I saw and heard and read that the Lord Jesus Christ himself gave everything to get the pearl. The church is the Lord's pearl. The Lord Jesus Christ, his pearl is the church, his people. He gave everything he had to get us. It's not only talking about us, but what the Lord did. The Lord paid it all. As the song goes, Jesus paid it all, and all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, and he washed it white as snow. The Lord Jesus Christ paid it all for you and me. We are his pearl. That's why when I saw that pearl, I saw the church was in there. The bride, the true church, not what they say, oh, I go to a church. Sometimes the church you go to is part of that bride, part of that church, and sometimes it's part of Christendom. There's lots of parts of Christendom that's not part of the real Christianity, those who are followers of Jesus, those who have sold everything they've had and followed Christ. Now, of course, just to break it, let me go back and put for the people who are not have a spiritual ear to hear. Of course, you know, not everyone is called to sell everything they have and go walking down the street and eating out of dumpsters. Someone messaged me and told me that was a gospel, and I was given a false gospel because I didn't tell people they need to go out there and eat out of dumpsters behind businesses and give everything they've got away. The Lord also said, if your right eye offends you, pluck it out and cast it away. It's better to enter heaven with one eye than to enter hell fire with two good eyes if your right eye causes you to sin. But, you know, it would be an atheist who would come on YouTube and say, well, you know, Jesus is evil because he says to pluck out your eye. He has an ear, let him hear. Think and judge righteously. The Lord said, don't judge by the flesh, but learn to judge righteously. That's the reason why people get tossed to and fro on YouTube and get caught up in false doctrines and foolishness and all this date setting for the rapture and everything. It's because they got secondhand faith, secondhand knowledge. They're thinking with a carnal mind and not by the Spirit of God. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty, there's wisdom, there's righteousness and joy, glory full of joy in the presence of the Most High God. But in order to be there and stay there and abide, he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High God shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, he is my refuge and my strength. Psalm 91, verse 1 and 2. You got to give it all. Just as Jesus said, the kingdom of heaven is like, you know, a merchant who looks to buy goodly pearls. And when he found one pearl of great price, he sold everything else. He didn't say, oh, let me have five pretty good pearls. You know, let me have some, you know, maybe some, you know, some Hinduism, and let me have some idol worship, and let me throw all this stuff in. He said, no, just one pearl of great price. And though for us, what is that pearl? That's the problem. That's the focus and problem of lots of churches, particularly the Roman Catholic Church is the biggest example that comes to mind. They think the pearl for you and me is the church. The pearl for the Lord is his church, his bride, the true church. Our pearl is Jesus. The pearl of great price for you to sell everything to get is not to become a member of a church, not to say that the church is the way, the truth, and the life, and if I follow your sacraments, your rules, and your ceremonies, I'll enter heaven and I can come to the Father and nobody else. No. Jesus is the pearl of great price for you and me. Give up everything you have. Jesus said, you know, except like he told the rich young ruler, you know, sell everything you have and follow me. Take up your cross daily and follow me. Jesus said, anyone who will not take up his cross daily and follow me is not worthy of me. What does that mean, brothers and sisters? What does the parable of the sower mean? That's a whole other video that the Lord had spoken to me while I was praying too about the once saved, always saved people. Go read the parable of the sower. Read about the seed that fell on the rocky ground and then there wasn't enough rain, and then later on it dried up. Those that got, and those that landed in the weeds, it got choked up with the cares of this world. They had a seed growing in them, claimed to be Christian, but they got caught up in the cares of the world. They wanted the pearl of great price, but they weren't really to sell everything and get it. Brothers and sisters, the mission, this is a whole other way of saying it. The mission of the Church of the Firstborn, and my mission for to deal with you, brothers and sisters, on YouTube, is to prepare you to meet the bridegroom, to prepare you to be that bride without spot or wrinkle, to be that pearl of great price, that the Lord paid the price for this pearl, the bride. But your pearl, can you hear me? He who has an ear, let him hear. Your pearl is not a church. And your pearl is not, like my pearl, is not making 100 orphanages. My pearl is not, being a missionary in the Philippines. My pearl is not visiting you in the States and praying with you or anywhere in the world. My pearl is not giving you a word from the Lord. My pearl is not in riches of this world. Your pearl is not in riches of this world. Your pearl is not getting a word from me or somebody else. Your pearl is not even the rapture. That's our blessed hope. But our pearl that we should sell everything and get is the Lord Jesus Christ himself. Now, when you can get the revelation and get it through your mind that it's Jesus himself that we pursue, don't pursue to be healed. Pursue the healer. Can you understand? Does he have an ear? Let him hear what the Spirit of the Lord says to the church. Stop seeking to be healed. Seek the healer. Stop seeking to speak in tongues, but seek the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. Seek him while he may be found. Seek him while he may be near. Call upon him and he will answer you and show you great and mighty things that you know not. When the Lord Jesus Christ was passing by Jericho, there was a blind man there that yelled to him, "Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy." Son of David is a title that they use for the Messiah. "Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy." And the people said, "Oh, be quiet, leave him alone, shut up." But it says that the blind man cried out even more loudly, "Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy." Jesus stopped, went back and said, "What can I do for you?" And he said that I may receive my sight. And the Lord said, "Let it be according to your faith." The man was healed of his blindness because he sought the Lord. No matter what anybody said, what anybody thought, what people making, tell him to shut up, people making fun of him. But he kept seeking the Lord. Now, brothers and sisters, that's a battle that I know lots of you who I talk to who are walking at a higher level, who are trying to walk close to the Lord. Just like myself as a pastor, we go through the same thing. We're the only one in our families, only ones, you know, when we go, people, they don't want to hear about Jesus. They think that people who are serious about the Lord are nuts. Well, guess what? I already gave up all those things. The people's opinion doesn't move me. That's why there's lots of people message me and say, "Brother Patrick, you're so bold on YouTube. You say what you want to say. You're not afraid." That's right. You know why? Because it doesn't move me. It doesn't move me. By the grace of God, may it never move me what people think about what I might say in a video. Now, brothers and sisters, let me put this, because there's people in, let me speak to you as carnal, as Paul said, not according to the Spirit, but as children, but not as mature adults. For those children who are watching this, it's not being prideful. Of course, if someone messages me by the Spirit of the Lord and says, "Brother Patrick, I think you made a mistake when you said ABC, and they're right, of course. There's a difference between receiving correction and people trying to keep you from speaking in the Lord's name and try to block you from the devil's spirit, from satanic power and demonic vomit, trying to tell you, trying to tell you to shut up. That's totally different than another servant of the Lord, another Christian who knows what they're talking about, correcting you in love. That's two different things. And it's sad that I have to explain that, because there's so many carnal-minded, immature people, of course, because this is a public forum here on YouTube. And I apologize to all those mature Christians that we have to keep going around the wilderness. Not only are we trying to advance in our understanding of the Lord, we still have to make another lap around the wilderness to try to pick up more, and hope that some of them will, you know, be quick to listen and slow to speak. You know, the Bible says if you rebuke a fool, you will experience his wrath. if you rebuke a wise man, he will take it to heart. And that's another way of saying what I'm saying. If someone rebukes you and it's right and you receive it as a wise man, then you're a wise man. But if you try to rebuke a fool, you will experience his wrath. So brothers and sisters, there are many fools on YouTube. And yes, the Bible calls people fools. Just as the text I said, the fool has said in his heart, there is no God. Now, brothers and sisters, I'm going to wrap this up. I've already been going for 25 minutes. And I've got more videos to make. Like I said, I praise God that the Lord anointed me to make this video, because I've been feeling pretty haggard with this this brownouts, or what they call them here, brownouts, this rolling blackouts in the middle of the night. And it's so hot here. You know, and then, you know, all the dogs are barking and the roosters are crowing, even in the middle of the night and all this kind of stuff. It can become discouraging. You know, lack of sleep is a big deal. It can drain on you. It's, you know, it's kind of a haggard thing. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I think God, for all of you, asks you to pray that we'll have rain here, moderate rain here in the Philippines, because a lot of our electricity is a hydroelectric plant that we have in the northern part of this Mindanao Island. From some waterfalls there, that would really give us a big boost if we had a good low pressure area, tropical depression maybe, that wasn't dangerous to bring us a good dumping of rain up there. Brothers and sisters, I appreciate your prayers for that. I appreciate all your prayers as we get ready. I only have a week left. I'll be going up to Manila a week from yesterday. A week from Saturday, I will be flying to the United States. Brothers and sisters, I ask you to pray about that, because when I get there, I'll be traveling all the way across, from Texas all the way across to North Carolina, then up to Philadelphia, a wedding I have to attend, to be a part of, to go there, and be traveling all around, getting ready for to see you guys. So I ask you guys to pray. I still don't know where we're going to live. We still haven't settled on a place that where we will live. I'm just, you know, the Lord told me he would show me clearly, and I'm still waiting on that. So brothers and sisters, I ask for your prayer and guidance, that, you know, the Lord would advise me where to live. And if any of you guys have any ideas, or you hear something from the Lord, my brothers and sisters in the Lord, I'm ready to hear from you. I also just want to tell you, I don't really feel good about what's going on with Russia and all that. I really don't feel good about it. You know, and I say I don't feel good about it, I just don't see a positive outcome. You know, I just see that the war of Gog and Magog or something like that may happen. United States, I mean, I don't worry about it. I'm just saying I don't feel good in my spirit about it, what's going down and what's going on. And I believe that it'll be sudden. Whatever happens, you know, with this, all this is going to happen suddenly. And I just pray, you know, there's no guarantee that the rapture is going to be, you know, we had World War II and there was no rapture. We had World War I, there was no rapture. There was nuclear bombs in Japan, there was no rapture at that time. There's no guarantee to tie that the United States is attacked and there'd be the rapture, does it? There's no guarantee of that, brothers and sisters. The rapture is prior to the tribulation, but we can have a war. The United States can be wiped out. It still doesn't mean it's the tribulation. Lots of countries have been wiped out. And there was no tribulation. It wasn't the tribulation. So just like what happened to the Jews in World War II and all that. But I just don't feel good about it. But here I am, you know, the way the Lord does me. Here I am going to United States, and it's kind of like a bad time and stuff. What can you do? But, you know, I trust the Lord. And just like all of you guys, I hope you guys also trust in the Lord and lean not unto your own understanding. You know, he will guide our paths and all of our ways. He will direct our paths, as the Bible says, you know. So I praise the Lord for his guidance by his Spirit. The Bible says, those who are led by the Spirit, these are the sons of God. Romans 8:14. I love to quote that one. You guys know that. I thank the Lord, you know, and then we can choose. We have to choose daily. As Paul said, you have to die daily, you know, crucify your flesh daily. And every day you have to choose to follow the Lord. You know, we still have that free will. Even though the Lord can convict you, the Lord can put the squeeze on you, the Lord can put the hurt on you, he can chastise you, you know, you can still go in rebellion. And that's why, you know, people can push and push and push, and next thing you know, they fall off the cliff after a certain point that only God knows. He says he will not always strive with people. He says in Genesis chapter 6. I mean, that's why we're going to have the tribulation. That's why God sent the flood, because he doesn't always keep striving with people. There's a point where God turns you over to a reprobate mind. You know, he turns you loose and says, you know, I won't try to keep dealing with you anymore. There's a point for, and God knows that point for each person, brothers and sisters. And I thank the Lord that the Lord gave me another chance. You know, His mercies are new every morning. So I thank the Lord that I'm still here. By His grace, I'm standing by His grace, by His effort alone. I'm just cooperating. Let's put it that way. To be a follower of Christ is to cooperate with the Spirit of Christ. To agree to submit to His will daily. To die daily to His will. You know, we all have our bad days, brothers and sisters. Especially when the power's out. You know, it can be rough. We all have our negative thoughts, negative days. But His mercies are new every morning. You know, great is Thy faithfulness, right? Great is Thy faithfulness, O Lord. Great is Thy faithfulness. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I'm pretty tired out. Have another video to make about, how about this, C.S. Lewis and John F. Kennedy. How about that? What do you think the connection is? I know, that's the problem with Google and all that. People keep cheating.